Milan Markovic comes from also Texas A&M, where he has taught since 2012. His principal area of research is predominantly legal ethics, but he teaches professional responsibility, business associations, and international business transactions. He practiced in New York City before doing a fellowship at Temple, and he also clerked for the Appeals Chamber of the International Criminal Court in The Hague. And so we are excited that he's going to move the conversation from what has been predominantly a court-focused, court-centered, litigation-centered conversation to talk a little bit with us about what would it mean for access to justice to see an alternative to courts? Where has that happened, and where can we envision some real reform?
Thank you. So when I was first asked to present by Sam, I happily agreed. He said, oh, you can do 10 minutes on Social Security disability insurance in courts, because he knew I was writing about that. Now, lo and behold, I'm here. I'm scheduled to speak for 30 minutes, right before a reception. I'll also note that the last time I was in this building, I was attending live Barbie lectures, which I don't believe they do anymore. Hopefully this will be a slightly less stressful experience, at least for me, if not for you. So the title of my presentation today is Alternatives to Adversarial Courts. When we think of courts, we generally think of two parties represented by counsel before a judge. And the judge is largely there to serve as an umpire to call balls and strikes, in the memorable words of Chief Justice Roberts. This is where I insert that I'm actually Canadian, notwithstanding my American legal training. Every once in a while comes in. The goal of this presentation is to argue that non-adversarial adjudication and non-adversarial courts are actually a huge part of the American legal landscape, and that perhaps we have more in common with some of our peers in Europe and their inquisitorial system than we might like to think. And perhaps if we think more broadly about the role of courts and how they can be reformed, that we can help mitigate lack of access to justice. Or at the very least, we can lessen the need for traditional attorney representation. So my focus here is going to be largely descriptive, and please feel free to stop me and ask any questions if you want any clarification. I'm going to discuss three distinct areas where I believe we have non-adversarial adjudication, at least in part. The first area is Social Security disability insurance. Social Security disability insurance is a benefit that's available to individuals who were in the workforce and then drop out of it because they claim they have a medical impairment that prevents them from working. These claims are adjudicated by the Social Security Administration, and they have a adjudicative arm known as the Office of Disability Adjudication and Review that holds hearings. Then we have asylum claims. Asylum obviously is available to individuals who have a well-founded fear of persecution if they return to their home countries. Asylum applications, interestingly, can be both affirmative, where someone's here legally and claims asylum, or defensive, where it's a defense to removal. I'm going to look at affirmative asylum applications, which are adjudicated by a distinct office, and asylum officers play a huge role. Lastly, I'm going to discuss drug crimes. Drug crimes, as we all know, prosecuted through the criminal justice system. But increasingly, there has been an emphasis on drug treatment courts. In fact, there are over 3,000 of them in the country. And the goal of these courts is rehabilitation, not incarceration. I'm not an expert in any of these areas. I've obviously looked at them to some extent. But they all have commonalities. Namely, they deal with serious problems and serious legal issues, and they resolve them in a way that we would consider non-traditional. So beginning with SSDI, the first step of SSDI is you have a filing with the Disability Determination Services, which are in every state. The examiners will look at the file, they'll look at the work history, they'll look at the medical evidence and make a determination whether that person should be entitled to benefits. There's a potential for reconsideration, but the claimant doesn't really get a hearing until the second stage there, which is the Office of Disability Adjudication and Review. There, before an administrative law judge, a claimant gets a de novo hearing. ODAR has an appeals council that's based in Virginia, and ultimately the claimant can file in district court if they're denied benefits, but for all intents and purposes, these claims are adjudicated at the first two steps. I knew nothing about the Social Security Administration 2 years ago, but it is an incredibly impressive agency if you just look at the sheer magnitude and volume of claims it deals with. In 2015, it dealt with nearly 2.5 million claims. This is just SSDI, right? Just SSDI. And it issued nearly 800,000 awards. And I've got the percentage there. But let's look just at ODAR, right? This is just the division of the SSA that provides hearings, right? So only hears a select group of the cases, usually those that have been denied in whole or in part. There are 1,600 ODAR judges. That's approximately double the number of Article III judges in the United States. They issued 700,000 decisions in 2015. Note as well the higher award percentage. Some distinctive facts about SSDI proceedings. First, they are ex parte. The Social Security Administration is not represented. So there's no one affirmatively arguing that people should be denied SSDI benefits. You might say, well, there's an administrative law judge. He's an employee of the Social Security Administration. That's true. But the judges are insulated from political pressure. And in addition, as the Supreme Court has held, but there's obviously internal training to the same effect, their role is not to act as counsel for the SSA. They are supposed to act as an examiner charged with developing the facts. In other words, they have to develop the record on disability. So given that the responsibility of the ALJ is to develop the record on disability, in my view, there is less of a need for traditional counsel to marshal evidence about disability, because again, that is partly the judge's role. This is what I mean by inquisitorial aspects of our legal system. The ODAR also allows non-lawyers to appear before it, as do other federal agencies. I think what's unique about ODAR is just how many of them there are. There are 5,000 non-lawyers representing individuals in ODAR hearings. 5,000. I've listed the qualifications here. They must be of good character. They must be able to render competent advice. But the interesting note here is that actually they're not really vetted by the Social Security Administration. Unless they want to seek payment directly from the SSA out of an award, they don't have to sit for an exam, and they don't have to have any kind of malpractice insurance or what have you, liability insurance. There are, of course, non-lawyer representatives who do go sit for the test and do have the insurance. They can get paid more quickly. But
they get paid by the claimant?
They can get paid by the claimant, or they can do a fee petition for the court. But those who take the test can get paid out of the award directly, so there's no exchange of money between the actual claimant and the lawyer. So we've got this massive system that one professor has called the largest legal system in the world, and we know very little about it at a time when we're interested in potentially expanding the role of non-lawyers in a variety of proceedings. So one thing we could do that we don't currently is track win rates by whether a claimant is represented by a lawyer, non-lawyer, or peers unrepresented. But what I can tell you is that the non-lawyer representatives are sanctioned at a very low rate, although it is much higher than the rate for lawyers who appear before before ODAR. So I don't want to say too much about that because it is such a low rate, but it might be worth exploring. But beyond Social Security, could this model be expanded? What I mean here is this model of inquisitorial judging and non-lawyer representation. Let me suggest an area where we might be able to do something like this, and we've talked about this area already today, housing court. We know in housing court, virtually every landlord is represented, although apparently there's data saying that it doesn't really matter whether the landlord is represented or not. And we know that virtually every tenant is unrepresented. So one thing that could easily be done is actively have those courts embrace inquisitorial judging. I know this is done in practice all the time, although my point is formally embrace it. Actually have the judges embrace and get training so that their responsibility is to develop any defenses that might be available in the case of eviction. And there are actually not that many defenses that are going to be available in most eviction cases. In addition, of course, we can continue to expand and focus on things such as navigators that were mentioned in earlier panels. But the overall point here is, rather than trying to figure out how we can provide everyone in housing court with a lawyer, which is going to be very, very expensive given that 99% of tenants in housing court are unrepresented, we could focus on inquisitorial judging and some role for non-lawyers. So the next area I want to discuss is asylum. So asylum obviously is available to individuals who wish to remain in the country for fear of returning. And I'm sorry if you can't read the lettering, but there's a number of stages to the process. The first stage is USCIS, the United States Citizenship and Immigration Services. It receives the original asylum applications. They do background checks. They do fingerprinting. The last stage of that process is an asylum officer interview, and that's what I'm going to focus on. Then, weirdly, if you're out of status and you're denied asylum by USCIS, you can be sent to the Executive Office of Immigration Review, which are essentially the immigration removal courts. And those are under the Department of Justice. So immigration judges are actually employees of the Department of Justice. Ultimately, there's a possibility for appeal before the Board of Immigration Appeals, and then finally, circuit court. But again, much of the action is in these first two steps. What do these asylum officers do? Well, the regulations suggest that, much like the SSDI judges, they should act in a non-adversarial manner. The purpose of the interview, note, is to elicit all relevant and useful information bearing on eligibility for asylum. They're not there, in other words, to interrogate the applicant. They're there to develop the facts on asylum. You might be wondering about the training of these people. Many of them are lawyers, some are not, but they all have to go through a 5-week training, which includes instruction on international refugee law. Very few law schools even offer a course like that. Includes instruction on U.S. asylum law, as interpreted by the Board of Immigration Appeals. Includes training on interviewing techniques, especially interviewing techniques involved that one should use with people who have experienced trauma. We don't teach that in law school, generally speaking. And they also receive weekly training once they're hired that would, for example, update them on country conditions. So again, it's not as critical, in my view, to have a lawyer in these interviews, given that you have a trained person whose responsibility is to find out whether you meet the requirements of asylum. And I would note here, I've handled a few of these asylum officer interviews as a lawyer, and the lawyer's role is incredibly minimal. They allow you to make a closing statement, and mine usually weren't very effective. So that's essentially the entire role of the lawyer in this and the actual interview. Obviously, the lawyer can have an important role prior to the interview.
Is that a formal limit on his role? He can't do more than that?
Yes, but some officers do have discretion to allow the lawyer to ask questions or whatnot, but most just do the closing statement.
Are these officers administrative law judges?
No, they're just employees of USCIS, non-administrative law judges. But I think Sam's already kind of understanding where I'm going with this. Here's the backlog in our immigration courts. June 2015, 450,000 case backlog. There are approximately 250 immigration judges, 450 asylum officers. So one thing we could potentially do to help reduce this backlog would be to give asylum officers an expanded role. Currently, they can only hear these affirmative asylum applications. Now, obviously, you have to be careful to ensure to put procedural safeguards that we don't want to foul due process and the like. But given this huge backlog and that many individuals appear in immigration court unrepresented, an immigration court is very much adversarial. The government is representing, actively trying to deport you. An alternative could be to try to expand this non-adversarial interview. And why stop with, and again, not endorsing this, but at least floating the idea, why stop with immigration court? We can think of other areas that we currently treat in an adversarial manner that need not be adversarial. Consider uncontested divorces. For a couple that's already agreed to divorce, and the only question is exactly what the terms are, there's no reason you couldn't have a trained person try to determine their assets, the marital property, and come up with a fair agreement that apportions the assets, rather than going through an adversarial process before an overworked family court judge. And of course, then we deal with the problem of, well, one side or the other might be unrepresented. So just, it's another alternative possibility that I think merits thinking about. Last example, and this one I think might be the most realistic, at least in the near term, drug crimes. We know that there's an incredible number of drug offenses in the U.S., but increasingly there's a move towards diversion programs where a prosecutor will give an offender of a petty drug offense an option to go into one of these diversionary programs that are known as drug treatment courts. The focus of them is on rehabilitation and treatment, not incarceration. The first one began in 1989 in Miami's Dade County. There are now, well, this was as of June 2014, so it's out of date, but there are at least 3,416 of them. I didn't even know this until I began looking into these alternatives to traditional courts. They're all over the country. And they have some clear advantages. So, for example, the focus is on treatment. You have a judge who's ultimately responsible for supervising the terms of the treatment, but you have treatment professionals and doctors working with the person who is enrolled in this program. They're going to receive much better treatment than they would in prison or jail. Rigorous peer-reviewed studies have found that this lowers recidivism by at least 25% compared to traditional programs, i.e. criminal prosecution. Sam will like this. The cost savings are significant. So $3,000 to $13,000 per client. So this is very sustainable if that's what we're worried about. And that's simply because incarcerating people is extremely expensive. And I think there's wide bipartisan support that we send too many people to prison. Lastly, and to pick up on what earlier speakers said, legal needs tend to multiply. So one benefit of these programs is they exit, people exit without a criminal record. That means you don't need an expungement process down the road. That means that when they exit, they might be able to get better jobs and support their families, so there's less need for benefits. And I don't claim that these programs are perfect. They're not available in all areas. Most of the people who benefit from them can't get into them. Some prosecutors might be reluctant to use them for whatever reason. Also, although I have incredible respect for judges of all stripes, the reality is judges aren't medical professionals. So anecdotally, at least, they're not very open to methadone treatment, for example, that is very effective for heroin problems and the like. So perhaps there needs to be some more, you know, education of personnel involved in these drug treatment courts. But nevertheless, I think the bipartisan support and the early successes of these drug treatment courts show the value of having lawyers and non-lawyers working together, lawyers working with other professionals. So we could certainly expand these drug treatment courts, and I hope we do, and I expect that we will. But I think even beyond that, what that allows us to do is to move so many of our resources that currently go to prosecuting low-level drug crimes into other areas, right? Make more funds available for providing counsel, perhaps, in other areas. But I think we can also think about, are there other areas where lawyers and non-lawyers could work together? People who have legal needs often have non-legal needs as well, which lawyers aren't particularly well-trained to handle. So why couldn't we have in law schools, for example, law students working with social workers, so that while the lawyers work on obtaining health benefits and the like, social workers could be working with them and their families to see whether what other source of public assistance might be available. At the very least, I think it's worth trying, and at the end of the day, we're not there to issue spot. We're there to help people. So here's my conclusion. I welcome any questions or pushback. We should stop treating non-adversarial adjudication and non-adversarial courts as some kind of outliers or anomalies, right, from our traditional system. They're very much a part of our system, and in fact, they handle extremely important areas, including social disability insurance, affirmative asylum applications, and some drug crimes. Their specific procedures may vary, for example, whether non-lawyers have a role and what that role is. But I think they show, and particularly given the high volume of matters that they handle, that justice can be achieved without having two parties and their lawyers appear before a Herculean umpire. And perhaps by focusing more on how courts operate and changing to some extent how they operate, we can obviate the need for expensive lawyer representation. At least that's my hope. Thank you.
Questions? Comments?
There was someone I know who had a question earlier, but since they sat down, I'm going to, I can follow up on this. So I'm, as I mentioned earlier, I'm with the Center for Court Innovation, and we're big proponents of drug courts and do a lot of training for drug courts and research. That being said, I also also work with the Department of Justice Office on Violence Against Women, looking at the offloading of enormous numbers of family law cases to non-adversarial processes that has really taken off in the last, I'd say, probably 15, 20 years. And the ways in which that has created, I think it's, Lisa could talk to this, but, you know, the family law system has, there are a lot of reasons for why that's happened, but it's created a lot of new problems in its wake, and a lot of the traditional mechanisms by which we ensured that there was, transparency, the appeal process, whatever, those things may not exist in some of these alternative mechanisms. The examples you cited are different and seem to have built that in, but just a note of caution about that.
No, and I'll just agree, I'll actually even add to that. I mean, one of the interesting things is there's such a push now for mediation and arbitration, and I think those can obviously have benefits and drawbacks. I think what with my kind of proposal about officers involved in family court, I think you could give them the kind of training where if they detect one of these issues, right, that they would make sure that, no, this needs to go in a different process. This uncontested divorce, right, has some issues that need to be dealt with. What I worry about now is, and I'm a big believer in the forms. I talk to a lot of family lawyers in Texas who hate them, but I think that was the right way to go. But you worry about couples seeking uncontested divorces who have custody issues, who have abuse issues in the relationship. So my hope is with these officers, I think with the training, hopefully you can detect some of that. And I will say anecdotally, from what I've heard with people who do immigration law all the time, I just did it on a pro bono basis, the asylum officers, in their view, are often better trained than the judges. Make of that what you will.
Go ahead, ladies
just
first.
Take her and then the
okay.
Dean.
Okay, I'm Louise Trubeck from University of Wisconsin Law School, now living in New York. I think this presentation opens up the whole question of when we're rethinking justice for all, it's an enormous field. And just to point out on the multidisciplinary practice, there's a lot of multidisciplinary practice that goes on that is never talked about. Again, it's an offshoot and somewhat hidden. And similarly, a new development has been the medical-legal partnerships, which is an enormously interesting new thing. And many of these systems decenter the lawyer. So once we move into non-lawyer practice, once we open up the whole box, there's just a whole lot of stuff in the box that can be opened up and looked at. So I think that's one of the questions. I mean, I think this book is great. It brings together all these areas, but if we could open up the box even further and look even more. So I think that's one of the questions, how much we want to do. Do we want to think really big, or do we want to concentrate on the more traditional ways we can do on the edges? And I think it's great to have this period of experimentation and trying all kinds of things, and I think it's an excellent thing to open it up to the non-adversarial courts and so forth, but we should allow lots of different ideas to get out there, because I think it's a moment when we're willing to open it up.
Very good. Boyle?
You did a great job, and you remind me of Richard Susskind's question in Tomorrow's Lawyers. Is the court a place, or is it a service? Mm-hmm. And I think when we ask that question, we really start really thinking about different ways. But I
is law a place? How can it be a place?
Is the court a place? Listen to me, Sam. Focus. Focus. You're not
Kinsman.
Focusing.
I know.
I've come all the way from Texas for this.
I know. Royal. Are courts a place?
Are courts a place or a service? Whoa. At any rate. Are you with me there, big
yes,
guy?
Yes, I am. Thank you, sir.
Okay, very good. Hey, right. It opens up those questions. You did a good job.
If I could just have a comment on that. There's obviously topics that are going to be discussed tomorrow, like online dispute resolution. You know, my goal with this presentation was merely to focus on what we're already doing. And if we focus on what we're already doing, hopefully it's less controversial to make modifications to courts that already operate in a very traditionally in a very adversarial model. I'll also just say about Susskind, I think his book's definitely well worth reading. I'm a lot more bullish on the future of the legal profession than Professor Susskind.
Now, Milan, David Yin was here on the Unemployment Action Center. Now, that's the inquisitorial model, limits on what attorneys can recover, right?
Mm-hmm.
The allowance of non-attorney practice, and at least these students feel, and I think it's true, that in cases where there are serious factual issues about whether unemployment comp should have been denied, an attorney is very useful. So even though it's inquisitorial, the ALJ has its own imperative. And we know from Social Security disability, because I did a piece with Ricky Revez on it a long, long time ago. He was here earlier today. But there was a lot of litigation in the 1990s about whether the ALJs were doing the right thing vis-a-vis the claimants. Now I know from the data that they're overcompensating. And actually, now the concern is that they're giving out benefits that are unmeritorious. So there's a political dimension to it. But I think there's a lot in what you say about non-adversarial administrative adjudication.
If I could just have one final point on that, and to bring it to tie to Dean Ferguson's question about courts being a place, and I don't think this is a good thing, but I just want to tell you it's happening. The ODAR is actually now doing hearings via video conference.
Video conference.
Which could be an issue when someone claims, for example, to have a disability involving their leg, and the judge can't even see their legs. Of course, that doesn't prevent them from talking about it or whatnot. But because there's a huge backlog there as well, and we don't have time to go into that, but that is something that they're currently experimenting with. I don't think we need to embrace that, but I think as lawyers, we need to understand that there's this huge system involving these claims that we don't talk about that much, but that can perhaps inform our understanding of other types of claims.
Absolutely. It's open for general discussion. Just come to the mics and introduce yourself.
Do you have thoughts in thinking about kind of what we've talked about over the course of the whole day that connect some of the dots?
Criticisms, suggestions, statements of approval, et cetera.
Well, I approve. Thank you very much for the conference. I actually want to push back at a theme that I think I've heard throughout the day that has sounded as if Civil Gideon is the gold standard or Cadillac, but we're never going to achieve it, so we need to talk about access to justice. I don't think anybody said it quite that way. I actually am both a believer in some form of a civil right to counsel targeted and an access to justice initiatives, and I think it's a mistake to always be thinking in terms of either or. I don't think we should be over-lawyering and providing lawyers in every civil case if we could is the ideal. I just think that's bad policy and a bad use of money if it's not important enough and it's not needed. But at the same time, I think as we're exploring all of the innovations we've discussed today, part of the reason I pushed when I spoke earlier of a three-pronged approach that included focusing on starting points for targeted representation was because I think it's a mistake to not take as a given that there are incredibly vulnerable litigants with basic human needs for whom we have a good sense this isn't going to be enough. So even in the area of housing, I actually completely agree with Milan that the judges should be pushed to be more helpful. In my work with judges, and I've done some trainings on judicial ethics, they actually say it's hardest for them where one side has a lawyer and the other side doesn't because they appear to be being favorites. And my point is you still educate, you train, you explain, and you do as much as you can, and then you provide other assistance. So when Roger Maldonado was talking about the Navigator program, I'm eager to see what the evaluation shows as to whether how much better people do, but taking a targeted representation, you could imagine as a policy matter, tough. If it's a roof over people's head, everybody gets counsel and we have to figure that out, you could figure out a messy sorting within there saying the combination of the judges doing more and navigator programs may get us 60% of the docket getting pretty close to what they can get, and then we've got to target the rest. And the last thing, and it goes without saying, I think, the representation is only going to be effective to the extent there are larger housing policies dealt with as well, whether it's affordable housing or rental assistance as well. I think certainly one lesson from the criminal side is we don't suddenly have a good system because we have lawyers. So I guess my plea is that we not discuss this as either or, and I think part of the obligation is sort of with every innovation, think about how exciting it is, but also have a sense as to where do we predict the limits would be so that we probably need to add other things to it.
Very good. Other comments?
Can I chime in on that really quickly, Sam? Just kind of point of reference. There's been a lot of talk earlier about multidisciplinary practice and innovations abroad. One thing, and just to, I share Russell's concern, England has embarked really since 2007-08 on this ambitious program of legal services deregulation where you can have non-lawyer investment law firms, you can have accountants working with lawyers. Deloitte & Touche is competing with big law firms in England. But while that's been going on, the deregulation, they've also been cutting back legal aid extensively to the point where they have a crisis and lawyers have been on strike. So I am very mindful of the danger he's evoked. So while we think of alternatives, I think we also can't lose sight of the importance and the fact that a lawyer really can't be replaced in certain situations.
Absolutely. Other comments?
I just have a brief comment. I'm Ann Juergens. I'm from the middle of the country here. And I was thinking a lot about due process while you were talking. I agree with many of your ideas. I know people who do asylum. I've done Social Security is the most non-adversarial of what I have seen. Someone earlier said unemployment cases, the judges favor the workers, and Michael Green and I were talking to each other and saying that's not our experience at all. And I think that I'd like to try some get rid of due process for people with power, and it's really been created for all of our the people I've been working with for 40 years who have no power. That's who due process protects. So this gets us to Mr. Yin said something about the moral question embedded in, I think, all of this talk is if we get rid of due process protections for those with no power, where is that going to leave us? And I don't know if there are experiments we could do on the outcomes if you had non-adversarial processes for those with a lot of power, and I was trying to imagine one, but that was my comment. Don't be naive about how due process operates.
I would be in favor of taking due process away from both rich and poor alike.
But mostly we've been talking about taking it away from the poor.
I don't think that's true. I don't think anyone's been urging that.
Okay, my name is Betty State, and I am the president of the Brooklyn Legal Services under LSNYC. It has been a great conference because there's been so much here that I'm constantly looking for ways because, as you know, as was said, we can only represent about 20% of the people that need, and we represent people in all the different areas. But one of the things we do, we have people in the courts that do intake right in the court. That's one of the technology kinds of things. And also, I was very impressed by the presentation by the young man who said that he is trying to train parents to know what their rights are in terms of representing their own children, because I'm of the mind that we have to empower people, and certainly in the communities where I work in Brooklyn, people need empowering. And one of the things, another thing that we're doing, we're going and constantly going from place to place to inform people now around deed scamming and foreclosure and all those kinds of things. So we see that as a way to do things, but coming here, of course, getting new ideas and going back and trying to say, can this make this a part of legal services also? Because we have to do so much. And things like lawyer for the day is what they're doing in some places. And so as we look at it, we come to a place where we hope that we will make some real ways of representing so many people, including middle income, like my friends, who can't afford really to have lawyers.
Thank you.
Hi, Lynn Kelly from the City Bar Justice Center. This was such an interesting presentation, and thank you for doing it. It got me thinking in particular about the drug treatment court, whether there aren't other areas where maybe the law has gone sort of too far in one direction, and then John Lobier's point, like, what about legal simplification? And one of the areas I was thinking about is a sort of a subset of the housing issue is the New York City Housing Authority, which has a fair hearing process that doesn't really try and help the claimants. And it struck me as that would be a really good area for reform, because they're essentially suing people who live there. First they go through a hearing process, then they sue them in court, and that really should be a problem-solving forum, and it's not used that way at all. So thank you for, you know, teeing up those issues, because I think if we all think hard about problematic areas where maybe there's been overzealous enforcement or government regulation, or it's just become an adversarial situation, and it really shouldn't be, because it's very expensive for all of us to pay for all those housing court proceedings they bring. So thank you.
Thank you, Lynn. Thank you for all you do, Lynn. Other comments, questions?
One more.
Judge?
Excellent.
And this will be my last one. Roy Ferguson from Texas. One of the things that I have trouble with, I agree with the comment about due process. I think we can start taking away constitutional rights as we go through this process. The other problem I have is I'm a great believer in the jury system. And over again, we're taking people's rights away from them to a jury. You can't sign a credit card, you can't do a mortgage, you can't do anything in the consumer area without waiving your rights to a jury trial. And the juries are the great equalizers of our society, in my view. And so I'm having trouble figuring out how we reach the right balance. But I do think we do have this pesky little thing called a constitution. And we can't forget there is a Seventh Amendment that gives us that right and is very important to us. I don't know how to reach the balance, but I'm struggling with it.
Thank you, Royal.
You certainly can imagine in some contexts we've played with in areas of juvenile law, things that people typically see as not as serious, having community member forums, right? I'm trying to think of, like, you know, things that we've stolen from tribal justice systems where they really are communities coming together, peers from the area that whatever the fight or the dilemma is, and the peers themselves are. It doesn't look like a court, it doesn't feel like a court, it doesn't have the rules of a court, but you have the community standing in for the judge. And I wonder if some of those experiments could be something that we borrow from when we start to think about how do we make this more democratic little d, and at the same time make justice more accessible.
Just an observation. Most of what people need from lawyers is transactional help. But our focus is litigation in everything we've said today. I mean, most people need you to review a document that they've got to sign, or they need help with a closing, with a small business they want to start. And there aren't lawyers for these folks, by and large. And it's something that people could do. See, my idea is pro bono as part of your life. Doesn't require you to eat up the entire week. There's a lot of that stuff that needs to be done and is not being done. And so this is an area, it doesn't come up in the statistics because they're not claims. And I'm not putting down the importance of claims, but it's a very important part of what lawyers do and in for companies, but it's also what they need to do for people that we're talking about. So it's something to think about, yeah.
And that includes wills and estates.
Absolutely. Wills and estates. Yeah. And it's really a role for a lawyer. When we talk about access to justice, I think it's something that we really should start focusing on, because there's a problem there as well. And it may not be as difficult a problem to solve as litigation assistance.
And there may be lawyers that don't traditionally do pro bono that could be tapped for things like that.
You've got the transactional parts of law firms that are just not involved in a pro bono program, except when they're representing, giving advice to nonprofits. I'll make that carve out. Yeah.
I hope I'm not staying in the way of the reception.
No, you've got time.
Pat McDermott, Salisbury University. I've really enjoyed...
You're one of our chapter authors.
Yes, and I've enjoyed the presentations today. And as you were mentioning probate, I just had to mention my story. So I got a cab waiting outside my house 3:30 this morning to take the train up from BWI Airport. And so I started talking to the cab driver. I said, yeah, I'm a professor, but I also litigate. I got my law practice. He said, could I ask you a question? I said, what? Do you know anything about SG? Which kind of impressed me when he asked that. And there was an eminent domain, then he asked. And I said, well, tell me your story. He said, well, my wife's dad died, and he didn't have a will. And I said, well, I'm not sure that's eminent domain. Let me think. And so I explained to him that, you know, and then I said, and I had a great professor that said, for the average person, even if you die without a will, it's not that much of a difference as long as you don't have mistresses and hate your kids. It pretty much goes the same place. So he said, well, here's the next problem. They were never married, but they lived together like 10 years. Right. So I said, well, now that sounds like maybe there's a common law. And basically, he started talking about how much a lawyer would cost, what he's been quoted. And I said, you know, you can actually just call the local clerk. You know, they run for election, and they really help you with this trust and estates. When people pass away, they can give you advice in the courthouse. It's a political office, and you file your papers there when somebody dies intestate. He says, oh, I think I'll make that phone call. So I kind of feel like I helped with this conference on my cab ride to the train station.
Yes, you did.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Other comments? Well, listen, thank you for staying. I think we have a reception over there, and we'll see you tomorrow morning.
Excellent.